Today we are going to discuss about short-term regulation of blood pressure. Short-term regulation of the blood pressure is controlled by the autonomic nervous system, that is sympathetic and parasympathetic. Change in the blood pressure are detected by the baroreceptors, which are situated in our neck at the level of aortic bifurcation or arch aorta and carotid sinus. Increase at arterial pressure is stretch the wall of the blood vessels. When there is excess blood or there is a pressure from the running blood on aorta, the baroreceptors get the message, sensory message, through the stretch of that vessels and trigger the baroreceptors. These baroreceptors then feed back to the autonomic nervous system and inform to the autonomic nervous system. There is a decrease and increase of the blood pressure on the wall of the vessel. The autonomic nervous system then act to reduce the heart rate and cardiac contractility via the efferent parasympathetic fiber. So if there is a high blood pressure, then through this message by the autonomic nervous system, especially from the parasympathetic, it could reduce the cardiac contractility and reduce the blood pressure, thus reducing. Decreased arterial pressure is detected by baroreceptors, which then trigger a sympathetic response. If there is low blood pressure, there is low pressure on the vessels, then sympathetic system will stimulate and it will control the from the baroreceptor, it will send the message, and then it will increase the contractility of the heart and increase the blood pressure. Baroreceptors cannot regulate blood pressure long term. Means this is a temporary phenomenon. That's why we call it short-term regulation of the blood pressure. Baroreceptor cannot regulate blood pressure long-term. This is because the mechanism of triggering baroreceptor is that it's a once a more adequate blood pressure is restored. Long-term regulation of the blood pressure. There are several physiological mechanisms that regulate the blood pressure in the long-term. The first of which is the renin-angiotensin elastase system. Renin is released by the kidney, angiotensin from the parenchymal cells of the liver, and aldosterone from the suprarenal gland. So this combination of three, these secretions, they causes a vasoconstriction and retention of the sodium and water in the body. So therefore, the renin-angiotensin-elastase system, renin is a peptide hormone released by the granular cells of the juxtaglandular apparatus in the kidney. In the kidney, there is a part which is known as the juxtaglomerular apparatus. It's a convoluted vessels, bunch of the vessels. They are present in the Bowman capsule. And it releases in response to sympathetic stimulation. If there is a sympathetic stimulation from the autonomic nervous system, the renin is released. Reduce sodium chloride delivery to the distal convoluted tubule. Decrease blood flow to the kidney. Renin facilitates the conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin, which is then converted to angiotensin 2 and using angiotensin converting enzyme ACE. There are several physiological mechanisms that regulate Angiostin tube 2 is a potent vasoconstrictor, means it contracts the vessels. It acts directly on the kidney, increases sodium reabsorption in the proximal convoluted tubule. Sodium is reabsorbed by the sodium hydrogen exchanger. Angiostin 2 also promotes release of the aldosterone from the suprarenal gland. ACE is an enzyme which converts angiostin 1 into angiostin 2, also break down substance called the bradykinin, which is a potent vasodilator. Therefore, a bradykinin of the breakdown of a bradykinin potentiates the overall constriction effects. Aldosterone promotes salt and water retention by acting at the distal convoluted tubule to increase the expression of the epithelial sodium channel. Furthermore, aldosterone increases the activity of the basolateral sodium potassium ATP, that increasing the electrochemical gradient for the movement of sodium ions. Means sodium ions are moved from the sodium potassium ATP channel and they control it. So aldosterone retains water and salt in the body by decreasing the reabsorption of these through the distal convoluted tubule of the leucophenol. More sodium collects in the kidney tissue and water, then followed by the osmosis. This results in decreased water excretion and therefore increased blood volume and thus blood pressure. So this is a long-term phenomena, how the blood pressure is controlled. Then antidiuretic hormones are there, means anti means against, diuresis means urine, excretion of the urine, means these hormones decrease the urine excretion. The second mechanism by which the blood pressure is regulated is regulation, release of the antidiuretic hormone from the OVLP of the hypothalamus. Means at the level of hypothalamus, these antidiuretic hormones, because hormones are controlled by the pituitary gland in the brain. Brain has controlled 9 pituitary hormones, 7 from the anterior lobe and 2 from the posterior lobe. In response to the thirst or an increased plasma osmolarity, what hypothalamus do? It responds to the thirst. If somebody feels to take a water, then response comes from the hypothalamus. Antidiuretic hormone act to increase the permeability of collecting duct water by inserting aquaporin channel into the apical membrane. It also stimulates sodium reabsorption from thick ascending limb of the leucophenol. This increased water reabsorption does increase plasma volume and decrease osmolarity. Further control of the blood pressure, you have seen there are different way of controlling the blood pressure. Number one was a baroreceptor, which is short term. Then long term, we have got renin, we have got angiotensin, we have got aldosterone. Then this blood pressure is also controlled by the hypothalamus by increasing blood volume or decreasing blood volume through your thirst. Means you feel to take the water or you do take the feel to take the water. Further control of the blood pressure. Other factors that can affect long-term regulation of the blood pressure are the nutriuretic peptides. Is synthesized and stored in cardiac myocytes. Means this ANP is produced in the cardiac myocytes, means muscles, tissues. It is released when the atria are stretched. When the blood comes from into the atria, from left atria and right atria, the quantity of blood will stretch that pocket, indicating of the high blood pressure. ANP acts to promote sodium excretion. It dilates the efferent arteriole of the glomerulus, increase the blood flow, GFR, glomerular filtration rate. Moreover, ANP inhibits sodium deabsorption along the nephron. Conversely, ANP secretion is low when blood pressure is low. Then another further control of the blood pressure through the prostaglandin, which is anti-inflammatory. Act as a local vasodilator to increase GFR, glomerular filtration rate. GFR means glomerular filtration rate, and reduce sodium reabsorption. They also act to prevent excessive vasoconstriction triggered by the sympathetic nerves and xenin angiotensin and response system. So this prostaglandin acts two places. First, local vasodilator and increase the GFR, glomerular filtration rate. Number two, prevent excessive vasoconstriction triggered by the sympathetic. It will stimulate the sympathetic nervous system, prevent the excessive vasoconstriction triggered by the sympathetic. The sympathetic system, when stimulated, it will cause the constriction of the glomerular vessels or other body vessels. And renin angiotensin in the stool system also controlled by the prostaglandin. So there are different control of the blood pressure, different way. Then clinical relevance is hypertension. When there is an increase in the blood pressure, we call it hypertension. Hypertension is defined as the sustained increase in the blood pressure. It may be primary of an unknown cause or secondary to another condition such as the chronic renal diseases or Cushing syndrome. Hypertension causes damage to the wall of the blood vessel, making them weaker. This leads to the number of pathologies, including atherosclerosis, thromboembolism, progressing to MI, stroke, or aneurysm. Means if the hypertension means tension on the blood vessels will remain for a longer period of time, there are certain consequences. Number one is the pathology developing atherosclerosis, means on the blood vessel there is accumulation of the platelets or fat. Thromboembolism, small pieces will come out from that plug and stuck in some area and causes a permanent or temporary paralysis. Then it can lead to the MI, myocardial infarction, with damage to the heart or stroke in brain or any part of the body. Means stroke means obstruction of the blood to the further tissue. And aneurysm means there is a damage of intima and media, and only adventitia will remain and the vessel will bulge out over. Then it's like a time bomb. It can rupture any time in the body. Hypertension also damages the heart itself by increasing the afterload of the heart. The heart is pumping against greater resistance, leading to the left ventricle hypertrophy. Means if there is hypertension, then there is an overload on the heart to pump the blood. And by that, the left ventricle will get enlarged. We call it left ventricle hypertrophy. This increases the risk of the heart failure in the future. Hypertrophy of the cardiac muscles also increase the heart oxygen demand, predisposing to the myocardial ischemia and ultimately angina. Hypertension is classified using the BHS threshold for treatment. Systolic blood pressure optimum 120/80, diastolic 80, systolic 120. Grade 1 hypertension is 140 to 159, systolic and 90 to 99 diastolic. Grade 2 moderate hypertension 160, systolic to 179, and diastolic 100 to 109. And grade 3 severe is if the diastolic is 110 and the systolic is 180. This is a very alarming situation. First line pharmacological therapy includes ACE inhibitors, means the conversion enzyme from angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 should be inhibited. Because if angiotensin 1 will convert to angiotensin 2, then it will cause vasoconstriction and blood pressure. So we use to inhibit ACE by ARV, angiotensin receptor blockers. We call it angiotensin receptors blocker, ARBs. Calcium channel blocker we can use in diuretic. Lifestyle advice include reduction of the salt intake. The patient should reduce the salt intake because salt, if there is excess salt, sodium in the body, then it will retain the water in the body and it will increase the volume of the blood and causes a hypertension. Reduce alcohol consumption, which is very common in Western world, already in Pakistan also. Stopping smoking, regular exercise and reduce intake of the saturated fat. Means burgers and all these things in the food, we have to stop. Cheese and butter and oily cooking, we have to stop it. Having worked too hard against the high blood pressure, the heart muscles can dilate, making it weaker. This can have severely detrimental effect on the cardiovascular system ability to function. Normal heart, you can see, and dilated heart, you can see, there is a big difference. Left ventricle is enlarged, right ventricle is enlarged, right? So we have to take care of that. Hypotension. Reduced blood volume, hypovolemia is the most common cause of the hypertension. This can result from the hemorrhage, bleeding, insufficient blood intake, insufficient fluid intake, you are not taking 8 glass of water in a day. As in starvation, like in Africa, Ethiopia, or excessive fluid losses from the diarrhea or vomiting. If there is excess diarrhea and vomiting, that can lead to hypertension. Other medication can produce hypertension by different mechanisms. Low blood pressure, also called the hypertension, is blood pressure how low enough that the flow of the blood to the organ of the body is inadequate, and symptoms and all signs of the low blood pressure flow develop shock. Low pressure along without symptoms or signs usually is not unhealthy. The symptom of low blood pressure includes lightheadedness, dizziness, and fainting. These symptoms are most prominent when individuals go from lying or sitting position to standing position. We call it orthostatic hypotension. Low blood pressure that causes an inadequate flow of the blood to the body organ can cause stroke, heart attack, and kidney failure. Its most severe form is shock. Means neither the hypertension is good nor the hypertension is good. Common causes of the low blood pressure include a reduced volume of the blood due to the hemorrhage, bleeding, or something like that, or you are not taking water properly, heart diseases, and medication. Cause of the low blood pressure can be determined with blood tests, radiological studies, and cardiac testing to look for the heart failure and arrhythmias. Arrhythmias mean disturbance of the rhythm of the heart. Treatment of the low blood pressure is determined by the cause of the low pressure. Upright position. If you are sitting or standing upright, you are sitting or standing with your back straight rather than bending or lying down. Hypertension is another name of the high blood pressure. It can lead to the severe complication and increase the risk of the heart strokes and death. Blood pressure is the force exerted by the blood against the wall of the blood vessels. The pressure depends on work being done by the heart and the resistance of the blood vessels. Medical guidelines define hypertension as a blood pressure higher than 130 over 80 millimeter of the mercury mmHg. According to the guideline issued by American Heart Association, remember one thing, that the standard of blood pressure has little varied from UK and European numbers, like 130 by 80 is given by the AMA, right, in November 2017. Here are some key points about hypertension. Normal blood pressure is 120, I have already explained to you, of mercury, but hypertension is higher than 130 over 80 is a blood pressure hypertension. Acute causes of the high blood pressure include stress, but it can happen on its own, or it can result from an underlying condition such as kidney disease. Unmanaged hypertension can lead to the heart attack, stroke, and means don't take it easy. If there is a blood pressure in any member of the family, we must go to the doctor and get the advice and start treatment. Otherwise, it's a life threatening. Lifestyle factors are the best way to address high blood pressure. Means you have to make your life active. If you're lethargy, lying in the bed, working on you from your chair and table, and you are not walking, you are not doing exercises, you are not controlling your food, you are taking more cholesterol reach a food or you are getting stress, any strains in your mind, then it can lead to hypertension. So next lecture we will start heart failure, right? Thank you very much. So this is all about today.